Welcome, I'm Glen Anderson, producer and host of this TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives. This series explores a wide variety of issues related to peace, social and economic justice, the environment, and nonviolent social change. We especially provide opportunities for the public to hear voices and viewpoints that are rarely heard in mainstream media. Mainstream media, politicians, and culture see the world in conventional ways. The establishment is stuck in how they see the world. In order to solve problems, we need to see things differently. This TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives, can help us see things differently so we can solve problems at all levels, from the local to the global. This series is called Glen's Parallax Perspectives. Here's what the word parallax means. Put one finger in front of your nose and another finger farther away. Close one eye, then open that eye and close the other. Your fingers will seem to move. This is called a parallax view. This TV series invites you to look at issues from fresh perspectives. Also, see much information about the issues that we cover in this TV series and previous episodes of this series at my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. And now I invite you to watch this month's program. This month's interview on Glen's Parallax Perspectives will contrast the dominant worldview, which includes greed, corruption, cruelty, oppression, and so forth, with an alternative worldview that is humane, compassionate, peaceful, fair to everyone, and environmentally sustainable. These positive values should be shaping public policy instead of the nasty values that drive public policy now. This month's program is part one of this topic. It focuses mostly on the problems in the worldview that exists now, but it will suggest a few solutions. Next month, December 2018, part two will focus more on solutions, the worldview that we want instead of the worldview that is problematic and existing now. For many years, public opinion polls have been continually showing that most Americans think that our nation is on the wrong track. This explains some reasons why the public disagrees with our nation's direction and how problems have worsened the past few years and the need to turn in positive directions. 14 years ago, my November 2004 TV program was titled Competing Worldviews, because some Americans, especially the political and economic elites, have one set of values and promote public policies supporting greed, contempt for the working class, abuse of the environment, and a militaristic foreign policy, while many Americans have more humane values and want more humane public policies. That was 14 years ago. 9 years ago, our nation became more polarized, especially when right-wing billionaires funded the Tea Party and started to seize control of the Republican Party. Therefore, I titled my September 2009 program, Stop the Bullying, Let's Discuss Politics Civilly, Rationally, Compassionately. That was 9 years ago. Since then, things have gotten worse. Right-wing extremism now dominates all three branches of the federal government and many state and local governments. The right-wing worldview is rooted in some common assumptions that are hurting our society. But most people still have better hearts and better sense. Public opinions keep showing that most Americans want politically progressive solutions to political problems. Most people want good quality health care for everybody. Most people want to take care of the environment and the climate. Most people want peace instead of endless wars. Most people want to take care of people who are having difficulties. We want fairness for racial minorities, sexual minorities, religious minorities, low-income folks, and so forth. The way that you see the world largely drives how you interact with the world. Your understanding of reality will largely drive what you do to reinforce or change the status quo. So during this hour, I will contrast the dominant worldview with a humane worldview that would actually solve problems and help our society. And as I mentioned a moment ago, this hour, this month in November 2018, focuses more on the problem side. Next month in December, we'll focus more on the solution side. And there really are solutions. In recent years, American society has experienced a serious upsurge of anti-government rhetoric, including more threats of violence against public officials. Trump has actually urged violence against ordinary people who disagree with him, and he's urged violence against journalists who report the truth. We've seen an increase in hate crimes against racial minorities and religious minorities. We've seen a continuation of war, torture, and human rights abuses by our government, cutbacks in vital social and health services, a mania for privatizing public services, intolerance of minority races and religions, and an overall breakdown in the sense of our common humanity. Are these things interconnected? Do they have common roots? Can we find solutions that will resolve these problems and restore our public ethics and our common humanity? How can we reduce fear and violence and build a society that is secure and nonviolent? During this program, we'll examine these problems, and next month we'll look more at solutions, although a few solutions are mentioned briefly during this hour. Let's examine the worldview that is currently dominant, the big picture of how many people understand the world around us and our social and political environments. Also, let's explore alternative ways to understand the world and positive ways to rethink our social and political environments. I presented a whole lot more information and links to many articles and sources of information, more than I could squeeze into this one-hour program and next month's one-hour program. You can watch the program, read a more thorough essay, and see links to many sources of information by visiting my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. Click the TV programs part and click the link for this program's title, Choose a Better Worldview to Build a Better World. So let's understand two very different ways of understanding the world. One worldview is greedy, corrupt, cruel, and oppressive. That worldview currently dominates the U.S. politics, economics, and power centers. In contrast, most people want public policies grounded in the opposite worldview, a worldview that values human rights, honesty, a fair sharing of resources, a clean environment, serving the broad public interest instead of selfish narrow interests, compassion for everybody, and so forth. Those two worldviews have been competing with each other for a long time, but the greedy, corrupt, cruel, oppressive one has grabbed much political power in the past few decades, and especially with Trump and the Republican Party grabbing control of all three branches of the federal government and many state and local governments in just recent years. Some mainstream Democrats also are subservient to big business and the military-industrial complex and endless wars. But the Republicans serve those more ruthlessly, and they also add blatant racism and blatant sexism and blatant attacks on democracy and truth. But neither party is doing anywhere near what we really need or what the public wants. The corruption and cruelty are not inadvertent byproducts of otherwise benign policies. Rather, these abuses and cruelties are deliberately intended. Our government has been hijacked by people who oppose human rights, democracy, and truth itself. Blatant lying, blatant corruption, and blatant cruelty are running rampant now. Constitutional democracy is in very severe danger. I believe that the United States is facing the most serious existential crisis in our nation's entire history. The Civil War was about several states breaking away from the rest of the nation, but the current crisis directly threatens the U.S. Constitution and the basic principles of democracy. Trump is deliberately jeopardizing human civilization, not only by destroying the Earth's climate, but also by recklessly threatening to start a nuclear war. Republicans also have hijacked religion to serve their purposes. In the 1970s, the Republican Party and the religious right effectively merged, with each entity exploiting the other for its own ideological and power-grabbing purposes. The result of this merger has hurt honest religion, in addition to hurting women, public health, democracy, and truth. Trump has very serious psychiatric problems and is grossly unfit for public office. The Republican Party, which during the 2015-2016 presidential primaries was leery of this ignorant, unqualified, and reckless charlatan, has succumbed to his exploitation and obediently enabling his extremism because they're achieving their own political agenda. The Democratic Party pretends to disagree, but fails to publicly expose the extreme, crazy, illegal, and unconstitutional behavior for what it is. Fails to reach out to mobilize public opinion to stand up and organize and protect constitutional democracy, and fails to push hard for two constitutional remedies, impeachment and the 25th Amendment. Neither of the two big political parties is behaving responsibly. So although most of my criticism during this hour is of the Republican Party, both big political parties are wholly responsible. At several points during this TV program, I'll propose some positive alternatives. I'll urge us to replace the currently dominant worldview with the opposite worldview, one that values truth, fairness, compassion, human rights, nonviolence, peace, and environmental sustainability. These would solve many of our nation's problems and create a society that's much healthier and much happier in many ways. So this month's program analyzes the problems. Next month, in December 2018, we'll focus more on the solutions. Part one is this month, part two next month. A moment ago, I used the term worldview. A worldview is the overall perspective from which a person or a group sees and interprets the world around us. A worldview reflects beliefs and assumptions about what is real, what is good, and therefore what we should do. A person who believes the world is inherently cruel and unjust will likely behave cruelly and unjustly in order to fit in. The person will feel powerless to eliminate cruelty and injustice, but a person who believes that we can indeed solve problems and can learn how to organize nonviolently from the grassroots to make the world a better place, if that's your worldview, then we can indeed solve the problems. So the worldview that each person has and that our society as a whole demonstrates drives how we interact with the world around us, and we either reinforce or change the status quo. So you can choose how skillfully and how vigorously you work to change the world to better reflect your values and your worldview. So we contrast the status quo with what we want instead. So the current worldview is based on some values or some beliefs, some assumptions, some premises, like it's a tough world out there, you've got to arm yourself and violently fight back, you got to look out for number one and elbow everybody else out of the way, you got to dominate and control other people, the United States as a nation has a right to dominate and control other nations, we need to conquer nature and use up all the resources, and these are the kinds of things that are in the dominant worldview. The other worldview is very much the opposite. It sees the world as having the potential for being humane and fair and inclusive and compassionate. So you include everybody, make sure everybody's needs are met. If we share, there'll be enough for everybody. Cooperation is better than competition. We need to practice nonviolence, respect nature, respect the environment, use resources sparingly. Understand the complexity so we can make informed decisions instead of rigid right and wrong exclusions. So each worldview leads to very different results in how we conduct our society and how we interact with the rest of the world. And each worldview drives U.S. foreign policy, domestic policies, economic systems, how we treat each other at the family and neighborhood level, as well as at the global level and the national level. A lack of empathy allow selfishness, greed, cruelty, and oppression to hurt other people. Powerful people have made our society more brutal so that they can gain financial and political power. A major impediment that interferes with pursuing the common good is that many of our people lack empathy for other people. Many of our nation's political and economic and social problems were caused by a shortage of empathy, a failure to recognize our common humanity and to share the world with other people and people who are different from ourselves. As a result, we blame people who are suffering instead of helping them. Also, we blame other countries for things that the United States does too, but we fail to recognize that the United States has these shortcomings. We just project our shortcomings onto other nations and blame them for what we do. In contrast, a society that's civilized and fair to everybody must value empathy for everybody, including people who are different and people who are suffering. A decent society recognizes that every person everywhere in the world is part of one human family, and we have to protect vulnerable people from the dangers out there. Trump and many members of Congress continually express racism and sexism and contempt for refugees and contempt for people who have the wrong religions. They want to take away health care from tens of millions of Americans, despite knowing that this would cause tens of thousands of Americans to die needlessly every year. They refuse to fund programs for people in need in the United States and elsewhere. Their worldview excludes empathy. Don't let anybody tell you that the Republican Party is pro-life. Their decisions to take away health care and to underfund poverty programs causes people to die. Their destruction of environmental protections causes people to get sick and die. The Republican Party is not pro-life. Their policies actually kill fetuses as well as people who've been born of all ages, from young people all the way up to the old. They are overtly hostile to women's rights and women's dignity. Trump has bragged about sexually assaulting women and grabbing their private parts. Some American elites seem to feel entitled to exploit other nations and their natural resources for our own greed and deny other nations the right to control their own resources. People want to keep their taxes low, so they oppose paying for social services, mental health services, schools, health care, and so forth. And this lack of empathy leads to unfortunate byproducts, sickness, death, and so forth, and also leads to overt violence. A lot of people are carrying guns and they're trigger happy, but this only threatens everybody else's security. Martin Luther King said in his famous Beyond Vietnam speech at Riverside Church, New York City, April 4, 1967, quote, "We are called to speak for the weak, for the voiceless, for the victims of our nation, for those it calls enemy, for no document from human hands can make these humans any less our brothers. I think of them too, because it's clear to me that there will be no meaningful solution until some attempt is made to know them and hear their broken cries," unquote. There's a lot of greed that's part of the dominant worldview. The greed hurts individuals, hurts our society as a whole, hurts the environment. People try to take more than their fair share. And this notion of corporate personhood that appeared in the late 1800s has given business corporations way more power than was ever previously intended. And the Supreme Court and Congress have just accentuated that over the years. The dominant worldview supports competition that lets powerful people dominate weaker people. The early notions of capitalism anticipated there'd be lots of producers competing with each other for customers. But instead, we've got these monopolies, these gigantic mergers and things that end up being monopolies that squelch the real free market. And I appreciate a book written by a fellow named Alfie Kohn, K-O-H-N, titled No Contest, The Case Against Competition. He researched and found that competition in many areas actually hurts people in any ways. Our society keeps getting polarized into us versus them. This hurts various kinds of people, and it hurts society as a whole. oppressors like to use a divide and conquer strategy to pit vulnerable people against each other. We need to recognize what they're doing and resist that polarization. The cynical assumption that might makes right enables and entitles powerful people to dominate weaker people. The slogan is a cynical law of the jungle kind of assumption, and they use not only personal power, but also guns, military power, and so forth to oppose and dominate other people. Folks who assault and rape use that assumption that might makes right. So do militaries and all kinds of bullies from the schoolyard on up to the White House. The dominant worldview is full of this. And the criminal justice system also uses that dominant worldview to hurt people instead of protecting people from violent crime. Violent policing, harsh prison sentences, and the death penalty all reveal a worldview steeped in cruelty and vindictiveness instead of healing and thoughtful preventive efforts. They would rather punish people than actually reduce crime by using methods that have been proven to reduce crime. They would rather bully people than solve actual problems. So the two opposing worldviews I'm talking about on this program and more in the second program lead to very different approaches to criminal justice. If we want our society to be civilized, safe, and free, we have to debunk that heavy-handed, punishment-oriented system that does not help victims, that causes criminals or prisoners to end up committing more crimes again when they're released, and fails to protect society. Instead, we can recognize that evidence-based research has proven that more humane strategies work better. We can invest in better services for at-risk children and families, and save tax dollars as well as saving lives. Restorative justice is a great method. I've got information about that posted on my blog's criminal justice category. Death penalty is horribly saturated with this dominant worldview. It does not deliver what it promises. It causes other problems. And you can see the death penalty category on my blog as well. U.S. foreign policy and our endless unwinnable wars are also based on that dominant worldview that assumes that violence works instead of honestly seeking fairness and peace for the rest of the world and ourselves. The premise of U.S. foreign policy is that the United States is good and all the nations that we oppose are all evil, so we are justified in using violence, but they are not. And so when nations or political groups are in conflict, each side sees itself in absolute terms of righteousness. We don't understand the other side's perception of reality, but we feel justified in using our violence to destroy other people. But when somebody else does that, we call that terrorism. What we need are good conflict resolution procedures based on objective criteria and even-handed justice. In contrast, wars are based just on violence. And some people think that peace supporters are naive. But for thousands of years, we've been using war, and all that does is cause more wars. World War I was promoted as the war to end all wars. That ended in 1918, and have we had a century of peace since then? Wars just cause more wars. They don't solve problems. And there's information, again, on my blog on the peace, nonviolence, and international affairs sections. These dominant worldviews include the arrogance of power. During the Vietnam War, United States Senator William Fulbright denounced what he called the arrogance of power. The specific context was the Vietnam War, but this is a factor in U.S. foreign policy and in economic policy and throughout our domestic society. The concept extends into all kinds of ways in which powerful people assume that they are entitled to abuse people with less power. So men are entitled to sexually harass and sexually assault women. And we saw this in the U.S. Senate just in October when the Republicans steamrollered the appointment of Kavanaugh despite very serious claims that he had been sexually assaulting women. But women don't count. Truth doesn't count. All you have to do is just win at all costs, no matter what. The sense of privilege also causes white people to abuse people of color. It causes all kinds of privilege disparities, and it's a key part of the worldview in the USA. Just imagine how pleasant and how satisfying it would be to live in a society that did not have the arrogance of power, where people treated each other in a very egalitarian way. That's what we need instead. What's the role of government? The dominant worldview has a very negative view. Ordinary people really do want government to protect us and to serve us. In recent decades, the radical right wing grew and made our political climate much angrier. Grover Norquist, who works with a conservative anti-tax organization, was famously quoted as saying, "My goal is to cut government in half in 25 years to get it down to the size where we can drown it in the bathtub." The radical right is trying to destroy most of government, specifically the parts of the government that help people, but they support the parts of the government that punish and use violence and harass and hurt people. More violent policing, more prisons, more abuse of immigrants, more violence in foreign policy. But they don't want the government to be helping people. In Washington State, Tim Eymann's anti-tax initiatives have been part of that. They prevent the legislature from having enough money to fund the things that we need. We're seeing this especially now that Republicans are running Congress and the White House. And Trump has been appointing people who are utterly unqualified and in many cases overtly hostile to the agencies that he's appointing them to head. So if somebody to head an agency to protect the environment, he appoints somebody who is extremely hostile toward that agency and wants to abolish the agency and puts them in charge. People heading up civil rights agencies and civil rights divisions in other agencies, he appoints people who have long careers opposing equal rights for women, minorities, and so forth. He's trying to sabotage and destroy the government, and the Senate, dominated by Republicans, just rubber stamps those people. They're all part of the same problem. They keep trying to take away health care from tens of millions of Americans, and that will cause people, as I said earlier, to get sick and die unnecessarily. Trump is not making America great. He's making America poor, polluted, sick, and dead. We really do need good governmental laws, regulations, and services, things to help us, to protect our environment, to protect our health, and so forth. Taxes are how society works together to pay for what we need. Some people just rant and rave against taxes, but taxes are how a society works together to pay for what society needs. The anti-tax zealots have been slashing funding for public spending, starting with California's Proposition 13 in 1978 and extending really throughout the nation. Reagan escalated that when he was not only governor of California, but president of the United States, and it's going hell-bent now. In December 2017, Trump and the Republicans gave tax cuts that slashed the taxes for the richest people and the big corporations, and they ballooned the deficit. For decades, the Republicans have been railing against deficits and deficit spending, but they added like another trillion or so dollars to the annual deficit just by cutting off that revenue stream. And so they're trying to bankrupt the United States and destroy the government by choking off the supply of funding. A number of our current systems and institutions impose systemic institutional violence in some ways. People have said war is a theft from the poor. Sexism, racism, poverty, homophobia, other denials of human rights are inherently violent against the people who suffer as a result. Privatization is part of this as well. They're slashing public accountability by turning resources over to private hands so they can exploit it, turn a profit, reduce the quality of service, and not be accountable to the voters. Research has shown that utilities for electricity and so forth that are owned by the public, by municipalities and counties and so forth have better quality service at lower rates than the ones owned by business corporations. Ordinary people's incomes peaked in about 1976-77, and people have been sliding ever since, especially when compared with inflation. People are angry and fearful about their economic loss, but their anger and their fears have been hijacked by right-wing politicians who have tried to blame different other groups, minorities, immigrants, whatever, for that loss. They're trying to deflect the fear and the anger that they themselves had caused. And we need to not allow that to happen. The media have been increasingly concentrated in ownership by right-wing corporations who, instead of reporting the truth as an honest journalist would, put out basically Republican propaganda. The Fox News has been just a cynical front for the Republican Party as long as it's been around, for several decades now. And so they're manipulating the people who are stuck in communities that don't have enough competing voices of journalism. And so people have been propagandized, and people end up voting for right-wing extremists, even though those right-wing extremists are hurting the people who voted for them. But this is what happens when we don't have a fair, diverse media. So we need to distinguish between those contrived and exploited fears versus legitimate fears that people do have. We should be afraid about what is happening to our environment and our climate. We should be afraid about what the government is doing to make nuclear war more likely. We should be afraid about the cutbacks in food safety regulations that are allowing our food to be less safe for us, and so forth. And again, some aspects of this are bipartisan. Barack Obama and others have been guilty of war crimes and hurting immigrants. Obama had deported more immigrants than any previous, or than I think than any previous president. And Trump is not is just carrying that on. Barack Obama had carried on Dick Cheney's cruel foreign policy of endless wars on terror, and that's all baloney. We have this foreign policy that is imbued with this. Think back to 1823 when President Monroe issued a national policy, the Monroe Doctrine, that basically told Europe, don't get involved in Latin America. That really is our empire. And we extended our imperialism across the Pacific Ocean in 1898 when we fought with Spain and we captured the Philippines and a number of Pacific colonies and Cuba. After World War II, the United States emerged as the world's most dominant military and economic force, and we've been exploiting the rest of the world since then. There's a quotation from George Kennan, who was the head of the U.S. State Department's policy planning staff in 1948. Here's what he said. We have about 60% of the world's wealth, but only 6.3% of its population. In this situation, we cannot fail to be the object of envy and resentment. Our real task in the coming period is to devise a pattern of relationships which will permit us to maintain this position of disparity. The day is not far off when we are going to have to deal in straight power concepts. And this is just 3 years after the end of World War II, and we can see what's happened. This reflects the dominant worldview. We keep overthrowing democracies in Iran, Guatemala, Chile, Venezuela, and elsewhere. We keep installing and propping up dictators. We're just in very terrible condition because that worldview is bipartisan and it's decades long. It's very thoroughly entrenched in the U.S. Collective national worldview, and we need to get out of that. We need to break free. So Americans say that they're afraid of terrorists, but they also have deep and troubling fears about the crumbling economy, the loss of civil liberties, the deteriorating environment, the failure of our kids and grandkids to have a life as good as what we're having now. The dominant worldview keeps deliberately escalating the wrong kinds of fears and unwittingly escalating the legitimate fear, the things that we actually are, should be afraid about and really are afraid about. They keep escalating those problems, and all that does is trap us further in fear. The dominant worldview controls, as I said, both political parties. We need to understand something related to this, which has been referred to as the myth of redemptive violence. Many movies, Westerns, crime movies, spy movies, and so forth, end with a big shootout or a big explosion or some other violence at the end, and that violence is what resolves the problem and restores rightness and justice just before the movie ends. This is the myth of redemptive violence. Mainstream public opinion believes in the myth of redemptive violence. Our foreign policy reflects that myth. The foreign policy is that if we just send out the Marines, if we just bomb somebody, that's going to solve the problem. And actually, the problems that exist in the world are political problems and economic problems and social problems. And you cannot kill your way into solving those problems. You've got to use diplomacy, honesty, empathy, compassion, justice, a sense of what's fair and right. So you can't fight fire with fire, as they say. The way to fight fire is with water. And we have to fight violence with non-violence. Deliberate lies have been increasing in the past few years. Political conflict has become just horribly toxic. In a few minutes, I'll talk about Trump's lies in particular, but just lying overall is problematic. People who don't trust the government have good reasons not to trust it, because the Johnson and Nixon administrations lied to us in Vietnam, the Bush administrations lied to us about Iraq and Afghanistan, the government keeps lying to us over and over again. Businesses, banks, other major institutions have lied to us and abused us. Wall Street, mainstream news media, companies that hurt the environment, everybody is lying to us. So it's reasonable to distrust all of these big entities because they've betrayed us so many times. We don't even have the same reality that we used to. Decades ago, everybody watched the same three big networks and read the same local newspapers, and that's back when newspapers used to have reporters. And so we had kind of a common understanding of what the world was like, what reality was. But now people are polarized, and so liberals and progressives read their news media and watch and listen to their news media. Conservatives do theirs. Right-wing extremists do theirs. And we don't even have the same understanding of what is real, what is true. And a healthy democracy needs to seek truth and promote civil dialogue and allow differences of opinion and move toward solving problems by hearing each other and working our way toward workable solutions. Instead, we've been seeing a deliberate polarization and deliberate lies, political anger and hatred, and extreme partisanship. Especially the Republicans have moved the partisanship. Democrats have really been, I think, too timid to challenge them very effectively. As I mentioned a few minutes ago, billionaires and giant corporations have bought up mainstream news, and especially those have a preponderance of right-wing bias. One of the methods that notorious liars use is to keep telling lies over and over and over again until people start to believe them, and Trump is doing that. Oil companies have known for decades that their emissions were damaging public health and the climate, but they spent huge amounts of money for decades on propaganda denying that, huge amounts of money on election campaigns and lobbyists so they could suppress the truth, hurt all of us for their profit, and that's where this climate denialism has gone on for so long. Some articles have talked about this further, and I've got some of that information on the media part and the conservatism and right-wing part of my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. The dominant worldview has been so much more extreme and so much more cruel than it was even when I did the 2004 TV program. 14 years ago. And we don't have anything that even pretends to care about the public well-being. It's all about winning, no matter how bare-knuckled you have to be, no matter how much you have to lie, no matter how much you have to bully people and cheat and violate decent principles. During the years when Obama was president, the Republicans did everything possible to prevent him from exercising his constitutional duties, and they did that partly because he was a Democrat and partly because he was African American. Obama never proposed bold or progressive legislation. He did a few liberal things, but especially in his first four-year term, he just kept caving into Republicans and trying diplomacy to win their agreement on even modest things, but the Republicans kept rebuffing him. And now we have Republicans running all three branches of government, and we have these blatant bullying and lying things like Kavanaugh's appointment, where he has a history of extreme partisanship, extreme right-wing antagonism toward the issues that most Americans care about. And they steamrolled this through. They wouldn't even allow an honest investigation. It was very short, very much curtailed. You can't talk to these witnesses. And it was just a scam, basically. But they won, and that's all they cared about. And as a result, the Republicans have trashed the reputation of the U.S. Supreme Court. You can see information on the judicial and constitutional part of my blog as well. We see big money buying elections. Republicans support unpopular policies. What they're trying to do is stuff that the American people don't like. And so the way that the Republicans keep getting elected is by rigging the system. So they use big money. They do gerrymandering to rewrite the district map so they can win more seats in state legislatures and Congress. They do various ways to suppress the vote to prevent racial minorities and young people from voting, so that they prevent people who are likely to vote Democrat from voting. And they do other kinds of abusive gimmicks. They're on the wrong side, and so they just cheat. And that's what they've been doing. If you're like me, you get a lot of emails from nonprofit groups that say, please click here and tell Congress blah, 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 or please click here and tell Trump blah, 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 or tell Trump's agency head, da, 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 whatever it is. As if, usually these emails are addressed to the people who hold that dominant worldview, and our emails are the printed out emails that they have for us to click, tell those officials that their policies are causing bad results. Those emails are naive. Those officials already know that their greedy and corrupt and cruel policies are causing bad results. That's what they intend. Trump, for example, enjoys being cruel to people, and so telling him that the way he treats immigrants is hurting them, that's not news to him. That's what he wants to accomplish. He wants to be cruel to immigrants. And likewise, the same thing is true about environmental policies. They know that they're hurting the environment. They know they're destroying the environment and the climate. That's what they want to do because they really are owned by the oil companies and the coal companies. And it goes on and on and on. All these things are like that. These are not mere mistakes. These are deliberately and shamelessly corrupt and cruel. The Trump regime and the Republican Party really fully intend to hurt people, to promote racism, to promote sexism, to take away people's health care, even if tens of thousands of people die every year additionally. And that's been put out by independent governmental agency research that take away the health care, tens of thousands of Americans will die, and the Republicans want to do that anyway. Don't let anybody tell you that the Republican Party is pro-life. They are hypocrites. For Trump's supporters, many of his supporters, cruelty also is the point. It's okay to tell politicians that we see what they're doing, and we know what they're doing, and we're on to them. That's good. but they're not shamed by our emails with the standard wording that is given to us. We need to ramp up that wording a lot more and take additional nonviolent actions, organize at the grassroots to move society, to organize nonviolent grassroots movements to change public policies, and not just tell these people that bad results will happen from what they're doing. Republicans are doing the opposite of what Jesus did. Jesus fed hungry people, but Republicans want to cut off funding for anti-poverty programs. Jesus healed the sick, but Republicans take away people's health care. Jesus welcomed strangers and immigrants and poor people and people with disability and broke down barriers of his society's discrimination against people who were outsiders and poor and vulnerable. The Republican Party wants to do cruelty against those people. They're doing the opposite of what Jesus did. And do not let anybody tell you that the Republican Party is doing anything Christian at all. They are doing the opposite of what Jesus did and the opposite of what he taught. So one of the things that Jesus did often was he lambasted religious hypocrites. And that's what we need to do too. We need to lift up Jesus' words and show the Republicans that they are hypocrites. We can also mobilize the ordinary American people who have better values and show that the dominant worldview and the politicians and the political and economic entities that express and implement the dominant worldview are violating the decent values that most Americans hold and want to have implemented. To help lift up the end of Matthew 25, that says, you have to take care of the poor and the sick or you're going to go to hell. I mean, that's the Bible. Where are these conservatives on that? It's not just the Republican Party problem again. Just like in the Vietnam War and the U.S. Empire and our violent foreign policy and our nuclear weapons, a lot of this stuff is bipartisan. Republicans tend to be worse, but a lot of the core problems have persisted even when we've had a Democratic president and Democrats-controlled Congress. We have a bipartisan dominant worldview that is hurting all of us. Trump is mentally and emotionally incompetent. He is psychiatrically dangerous. He's unfit for public office in several crucial ways. And this has been well documented by psychological experts and psychiatric experts. His grandfather was an immigrant who did well in business. His father, Fred Trump, was a sleazy real estate developer who made millions of dollars by cheating other people in real estate deals. Donald was born a rich, spoiled brat, and he continued acting like a rich, spoiled brat all his life, and now at age 70 or so, he's still doing that. He seems to be only marginally literate. He very often misspells words. He seems unable to write coherent sentences. He does not want to read anything longer than one page. He likes bullet points and pictures instead of reasoned thoughts. He rejects rational information, and instead he makes decisions just based on his gut feelings. Many, many articles and some books have been written about how his top appointees need to dumb things down for him and need to treat him like a child and feed his ego so he does not have a tantrum like a three-year-old and take reckless actions. A web search on these kinds of topics reveal a lot of information. I posted some on the Trump and Trumpism part of my blog. Subconsciously, Trump acts like he actually knows deep down that he's incompetent. And so that's why he bullies people that he perceives to be weaker, women, minorities, and so forth, in order to make himself feel big. This is what bullies do, is they pick on somebody smaller, not an equal. So on a playground, the bully picks on the smaller kids, not people of equal size who could fight back. Trump's subconscious feelings of incompetence cause him to want to be militaristic, to have a military parade in Washington, D.C. to honor him. And this causes him to bomb other nations even when bombing serves no military purpose. When he dropped that most destructive non-nuclear bomb ever dropped in wartime in world history in Afghanistan, it served no military purpose. But people in mainstream media said, wow, how presidential he seems now. This is what he wants to do. He wants to boost his own ego by destroying and hurting. A great many professional psychologists and psychologists have written about his narcissism and his sociopathic tendencies. They've said he is mentally unfit to hold a position of responsibility. The Constitution provides for impeachment for somebody who has broken federal laws and violated the Constitution, as he has repeatedly done. The Constitution also provides for the 25th Amendment to remove a president who turns out to be unfit in health or mental ability or whatever. It's pretty vague, pretty wide open, so that can be done. We don't need to have Russians destroying American democracy, because Trump and the Republicans themselves are doing that very effectively. Republicans rigged the process for appointing Brett Kavanaugh, and they keep doing things that are destroying our voting systems and our democracy and our social integrity. During the 2016 campaign, Trump kept shouting, lock her up, even though Hillary Clinton had not been convicted of any crime. There's been no due process. This is just the kind of thing that a fascist or a dictator would say. Trump, in the 2016 campaign, Trump called for a Second Amendment solution to Hillary Clinton. And you know he was calling for somebody to assassinate her. Where's the accountability for that kind of recklessness? His animosity is just horrible. His appointments, as I mentioned earlier, are ridiculous. He nominated Sam Clovis to be the U.S. Department of Agriculture's chief scientist, even though Sam Clovis is not a scientist at all. He is a racist, right-wing talk radio program guy who had supported Trump's campaign. That's his qualification. But public opposition and ridicule stopped that nomination. A recent blockbuster report in the New York Times has provided compelling evidence that Trump has committed massive tax fraud, broken lots of laws about taxes. No wonder he won't release his tax returns and so forth. He lies. He abuses religion. The kinds of lying sounds like they talked about alternative facts, which are basically actual lies. In August 2018, Trump's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, publicly stated, truth isn't truth. Former Senator Daniel Moynihan said, you're entitled to your opinion, but you're not entitled to your own facts. George Orwell's 1984 featured a governmental agency that eliminated truthful information, and Republicans now are throwing inconvenient truths down Orwell's memory hole. They've been slashing information from scientific websites and so forth. There's a lot more information about that. They're using religion to hurt people. They're abusing religion. Let me see what else we need to say here. The problem, again, is not just the Republican Party. The mainstream Democratic Party does a lot of bad things, too. Currently, the Republican Party, and for a number of years, Republican Party has been much, much worse. Next month's TV program, part two of this program about worldviews, will provide additional sources of information, including links to nonprofit organizations and websites. Also, various parts of my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org, provide a lot of good information from fresh perspectives and links to additional resources. And also to watch this program and December's program about the solutions to all of this, visit www.parallaxperspectives.org, click TV programs, and then click the Worldviews episodes for November and December of 2018. Besides being able to watch the programs, you'll be able to read a very thorough essay with much more information and supporting examples and so forth and thoughtful analysis of what we said, and lots of links to articles and organizations that work on these things. Our nation is in a horrible mess. In many ways, the mess has gotten worse now that the Republican Party controls all three branches of the federal government and many state and local governments. Even worse, Trump is doing many of the cruel things that fascist dictators do. Certainly, we must oppose each specific public policy proposal that is stupid or cruel. But we must also figure out how to publicly expose the stupidity and cruelty in the worldview that has been dominating our nation for the past several decades and causing these horrible public policies to be implemented. It's the worldview's stupidity and cruelty have escalated these past few years, and the remedy is for ordinary people to understand how to change that, as we'll talk about in the December program, and to get organized and nonviolently turn things back. Ordinary Americans have better sense, and we have better hearts, and we have better values than the current dominant worldview. Let's help ordinary Americans activate their brains and their hearts to replace the dominant worldview with a worldview that supports peace, human rights, a sustainable environment, and truth. We do not need to settle for an us versus them world. We are all in this together. As the World Social Forum says, another world is possible. We can replace the dominant worldview with one that is thoroughly positive and humane. As I've said, this month's program has focused mostly on the problems with the worldview that currently dominates our nation. And so it might sound negative, but there are glints of opportunities embedded in some of this, and more in the information I had that we didn't have time to say orally, but it's in the essay on my blog. Next month's program, December 2018, will focus on solutions. Be sure to watch part two on the topic, Choose a Better Worldview to Build a Better World. Both parts will be posted to my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. Visit the blog, click TV programs, and then click both part one and part two of the Worldviews episodes. You can also read a much more thorough essay about this topic and see the links to many, many sources of information. The blog also has categories for several dozen issue topics on climate, environment, criminal justice, immigrants, peace, human rights, lots and lots of things. If you'd like to learn how to organize nonviolent grassroots movements for social and political change, please contact me. I'm offering a series of six workshops that inform and empower you at either very low cost or free, depending on what's going on. I just need to break even, but my time is all volunteer. You can get information about a wide variety of issues related to peace, social justice, and nonviolence by phoning me at 360-491-9093. We are all one human family. We all share one planet. We can create a better world, but we all have to work on it. The world needs you. You can help. Thanks.